Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Real Estate Investing for Dummies, 4th edition, by Eric Tyson, MBA, and Robert S. Griswold, MBA, MSBA, CRE. Narrated by Adam Lofbomm. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to tables and figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor the author shall be liable for damages arising herefrom. Eric and Robert's Principles for Success, by Eric Tyson and Robert S. Griswold. Real estate is a proven wealth-building vehicle. Investing in rental properties can generate current income and significant tax benefits, as well as build equity from appreciation over the years and decades. Although many people can succeed in investing in real estate, rental property investing isn't for everyone. Consider your investment preferences and personal temperament before buying property. Do you have the time to devote to real estate investing? Are you comfortable troubleshooting problems or hiring a property manager? Make sure you're financially fit before investing in rental properties. Pay particular attention to your monthly budget and make sure that you have adequate insurance coverage. Most successful real estate investors build their real estate investment portfolio through saving money and then gradually buying properties over the years. Don't underestimate the importance of establishing good credit. The best returns on real estate rely upon the use of credit to obtain the leverage of using OPM, other people's money. Your first, and often one of the best, real estate investment is buying a home to live in. Real estate is the only investment that we know of that you can live in or rent to produce income. You can also derive large tax-free profits when you sell your principal residence at a higher price than you paid for it. Focus on residential properties in the beginning. Residential property is an attractive investment and is easier to understand, purchase, and manage than most other types of property. If you're a homeowner, you already have experience locating, purchasing, and maintaining residential property. Among residential property options, our top recommendations are small apartment buildings and single-family homes. Attached housing makes more sense for investors who don't want to deal with building maintenance and security issues. Attached housing prices tend to perform best in developed urban environments. Have your real estate team in place before you begin your serious property searching. Line up a real estate agent, loan officer, tax advisor, lawyer, and so on early, because the real estate investor with the best resources can identify the properties to ignore and those worthy of careful consideration. Move quickly. The speed at which you can close a transaction is an advantage in any type of market. Look for properties in the path of progress. Areas where new development or redevelopment is heading are where you want to be. The best real estate investment properties are ones that are well located and physically sound, but cosmetically challenged and poorly managed. You don't get rich trying to find no money down real estate investment deals. Don't believe infomercial hucksters. Don't expect to buy top-notch rental properties that way. Making at least a 20 to 25% down payment provides access to the best financing terms. You can make smaller down payments, even as low as 10% or less. But you often pay a much higher interest rate, loan fees, and private mortgage insurance. Leverage, or the use of the lender's money to cover the majority of your acquisition costs, can boost your rates of return. But too much leverage can be dangerous if the rental market turns and your debt expenses are high. As the size and complexity of the deal increases, financing options become less attractive. The financing options for larger apartment buildings, 5 or more units, commercial, retail, industrial, and raw land, generally require more money down and/or higher interest rates and loan fees. But more advanced real estate investors can enjoy higher overall returns, plus the benefits of easier management and stability from long-term tenants. For low entry costs, consider real estate investment trusts, REITs, and lease options. You can buy these exchange-traded securities, which can also be bought through REIT-focused mutual funds, for $1,000 or less. With lease options, you begin by renting a property you may be interested in purchasing later, and a portion of your monthly rent goes towards the future purchase. If you can find a seller willing to provide financing, you can keep your down payment to a minimum. We prefer the adage of location, location, value. It clearly emphasizes location, but also the importance of finding good value for your investment dollar. Owning real estate in up-and-coming areas with new development or renovated properties enhances finding and keeping good tenants and leads to greater returns. Properties in great locations with extensive deferred maintenance, especially aesthetic issues that can be inexpensively addressed, are another great opportunity. Make real estate investments close by. Buy property within 2 hours away by your favorite mode of transportation. Venture further only when you really know another real estate market and regularly find yourself there for other reasons, or you've found an excellent property manager. Any decision about where to invest starts with an evaluation of the overall region's economic trends. If the area isn't economically sound, then the likelihood for successful real estate investments are diminished. You're purchasing a future income stream or cash flow when you buy an investment property. What you pay for a property and the cash flow it generates makes a significant difference in the success of your investment. The key is identifying which properties sellers have underpriced. Don't rely on the seller's numbers when evaluating a property's potential. Speak directly with the seller to determine the history of the property and their motivation for selling it. But don't rely on historic operating results offered by the seller or broker. Develop your own numbers through evaluating the property with a team of qualified professionals who are specialists in the physical and fiscal management of real estate. The buy and flip real estate investment strategy can work, but it also has a downside. Buying and flipping can be a way to make quick money in real estate if you time your investments correctly in a rapidly rising real estate market. However, flipping can cause your profits to be taxed as ordinary income, and you could lose during a market downturn. Bottom line, real estate professionals and you should value a property based on the projected net operating income, NOI. Project the NOI preferably for the next few years. Projecting the NOI is time-consuming and requires a lot of experience, especially if you plan property changes to increase income and/or reduce expenses. Introduction. Welcome to Real Estate Investing for Dummies, 4th edition. We are delighted to be your tour guides. Throughout this book, we emphasize three fundamental cornerstones that we believe to be true. Real estate is one of the three time-tested ways for people of varied economic means to build wealth. The others are stocks and small business. Over the long term, decades, you should be able to make an annualized return of at least 8 to 10% per year investing in real estate. Investing in real estate isn't rocket science, but does require doing your homework. If you're sloppy doing your legwork, you're more likely to end up with inferior properties or to overpay. Our book clearly explains how to buy the best properties at a fair or even below market value price. Although we cover all types of properties, this book concentrates more on residential investment opportunities, which are more accessible and appropriate for non-experts. Although you should make money over the long term investing in good real estate properties, you can lose money, especially in the short term. Don't unrealistically expect real estate values to increase every year. Downturns in the local real estate prices may create temporary buying opportunities, but we aren't real estate day traders. When you invest in real estate for the long term, which is what we advocate and practice, the occasional price declines should be merely bumps on an otherwise fruitful journey. About this book. Real Estate Investing for Dummies, 4th edition, covers tried and proven real estate investing strategies that real people, just like you, use to build wealth. Specifically, this book explains how to invest in single-family homes, detached and attached condominiums, small apartments including duplexes, triplexes, and multiple-family residential properties, up to 20 to 30 units, commercial properties, including office, industrial, and retail, and raw, undeveloped land. We also cover indirect real estate investments, such as real estate investment trusts, REITs, that you can purchase through the major stock exchanges or a real estate mutual fund. We've always relied on tried and true methods of real estate investing, and our core advice is as true today as it was before the real estate downturn in the late 2000s. If you expect us, in infomercial-like fashion, to tell you how to become an overnight multimillionaire, this is definitely not the book for you. And please allow us to save you money, disappointment, and heartache by telling you that such hucksters are only enriching themselves through their grossly overpriced tapes and seminars. Unlike so many real estate book authors, we don't have an alternative agenda in writing this book. Many real estate investing books are nothing more than infomercials for high-priced DVDs or seminars the author is selling. The objective of our book is to give you the best crash course in real estate investing, so that if you choose to make investments in income-producing properties, you may do so wisely and confidently. Here are some good reasons why we, Eric Tyson and Robert Griswold, are a dynamic duo on your side. Robert Griswold has extensive hands-on experience as a real estate investor who has worked with properties of all types and sizes. He is also the author of Property Management Kit for Dummies, Wiley, and was the author of two popular syndicated real estate newspaper columns for more than 20 years. He has appeared for more than 15 years as the NBC TV on-air real estate expert for Southern California. And for nearly 15 years, he was the host of the most popular and longest-running real estate radio show in the country, Real Estate Today with Robert Griswold on Clear Channel Communications. Robert also holds the Counselor of Real Estate, CRE, Certified Commercial Investment Member, CCIM, Professional Community Association Manager, PCAM, and Certified Property Manager, CPM, designations. He earned a bachelor's degree and two master's degrees in real estate and related fields from the University of Southern California's Marshall School of Business. Eric Tyson is a former financial counselor, lecturer, and co-author of the national bestseller, Home Buying for Dummies, Wiley, as well as the author or co-author of numerous other best-selling books in the For Dummies series, such as Personal Finance, Investing, Mutual Funds, and Small Business. Eric has counseled thousands of clients on a variety of personal finance, investment, and real estate quandaries and questions. A former management consultant to Fortune 500 financial service firms, Eric is dedicated to teaching people to better manage their personal finances. For more than 25 years, he has successfully invested in real estate and securities and started and managed several businesses. He earned an MBA at the Stanford Graduate School of Business and a bachelor's degree in economics at Yale. Foolish assumptions. Whenever an author sits down to write a book, he has a particular audience in mind. Because of this, he must make some assumptions about who his consumer is and what they are looking for. Here are a few assumptions we've made about you. You're looking for a way to invest in real estate, but don't know what types of properties and strategies are best. You're considering buying an investment property, be it a single-family home, a small apartment complex, or an office building, but your real estate experience is largely limited to renting an apartment or owning your own home. You may have a small amount of money already invested in real estate, but you're ready to go after bigger, better properties. You're looking for a way to diversify your investment portfolio. If any of these descriptions hit home for you, you've come to the right place. Icons used in this book. Throughout this book, you will hear friendly and useful icons to enhance your listening pleasure and to note specific types of information. Here's what each icon means. Investigate. We use this icon to highlight when you should look into something on your own or with the assistance of a local professional. Remember. This icon flags concepts and facts that we want to ensure you remember as you make your real estate investments. Technical stuff. Here we point out potentially interesting but non-essential, skippable stuff. tip. This icon points out something that can save you time, headaches, money, or all of the above. True story. Listen for this icon to find real-life examples of real estate situations to help exemplify a point. Warning. Here we're trying to direct you away from blunders and boo-boos that others have made when investing in real estate. Beyond this book. In addition to the content of this book, you can access some related material online. Head to dummies.com and type in Real Estate Investing for Dummies cheat sheet in the search box to find additional tips for investing. Where to go from here? If you have the time and desire, we encourage you to listen to this book in its entirety. It provides you with a detailed picture of how to maximize your returns while minimizing your risks in the real estate market. But you may also choose to skip to selected portions. That's one of the great things among many about Four Dummies books. You can readily pick and choose the information you listen to based on your individual needs. Part 1. Getting Started with Real Estate Investing. In this part, understand that real estate is just one of many available investment options for you, and grasp why you may want to consider it in your investment portfolio. Identify the pros and cons of managing rental properties and how you can fit real estate into your overall personal financial plans. Examine the gamut of real estate options so that you know which ones may be better choices for you, depending on your circumstances. Separate fact from fiction when it comes to passive real estate investments, for example, real estate investment trusts, and riskier approaches like no money down and property flipping. Begin to assemble a team of competent professionals who can assist you with investing in real estate. Chapter 1. Evaluating Real Estate as an Investment. In this chapter, focusing on the potential of real estate investing, contrasting real estate with other investing options, deciding whether real estate is really for you, arranging your overall investment and financial plans to include real estate. When co-author Robert first entered the real estate field while attending college decades ago, his father, a retired real estate attorney, advised that he use his monthly income primarily to pay day-to-day living expenses and allocate money each month into long-term financial investments like real estate. This solid advice has served Robert well over the years. It's never too early or too late to formulate your own plan for a comprehensive wealth-building strategy. For many, such a strategy can help with the goals of funding future education for children and ensuring a comfortable retirement. The challenge involved with real estate is that it takes some real planning to get started. Contacting an investment company and purchasing some shares of your favorite mutual fund or stock is a lot easier than acquiring your first rental property. Buying property need not be too difficult, though. With a financial and real estate investment plan, a lot of patience, and the willingness to do some hard work, you can be on your way to building your own real estate empire. In this chapter, we give you information that can help you decide whether you have what it takes to make money and be comfortable with investing in real estate. We compare real estate investments to other investments. We provide some questions you should ask yourself before making any decisions. And finally, we offer guidance on how real estate investments can fit into your overall personal financial plans. Along the way, we share our experience, insights, and thoughts on a long-term strategy for building wealth through real estate that virtually everyone can understand and actually achieve. Understanding real estate's income and wealth-producing potential. Compared with most other investments, good real estate can excel at producing periodic or monthly cash flow for property owners. So, in addition to the longer-term appreciation potential, you can also earn investment income year in and year out. Real estate is a true growth and income investment. Remember, the vast majority of people who don't make money in real estate make easily avoidable mistakes, which we help you avoid. The following list highlights the major benefits of investing in real estate. Tax-deferred compounding of value. In real estate investing, the appreciation of your properties compounds tax-deferred during your years of ownership. You don't pay tax on this profit until you sell your property. And even then, you can roll over your gain into another investment property and avoid paying taxes. See the Being Aware of the Tax Advantages section later in this chapter. Regular cash flow. If you have property that you rent out, you have money coming in every month in the form of rents. Some properties, particularly larger multi-unit complexes, may have some additional sources, such as from parking, storage, or washers and dryers. Remember, when you own investment real estate, you should also expect to incur expenses that include your mortgage payment, property taxes, insurance, and maintenance. The interaction of the revenues coming in and the expenses going out is what tells you whether you realize a positive operating profit each month. Reduced income tax bills. For income tax purposes, you also get to claim an expense that isn't really an out-of-pocket cost. Depreciation. Depreciation enables you to reduce your current income tax bill and hence increase your cash flow from a property. We explain this tax advantage and others later in the Being Aware of the Tax Advantages section. Rate of increase of rental income versus overall expenses. Over time, your operating profit, which is subject to ordinary income tax, should rise as you increase your rental prices faster than the rate of increase for your property's overall expenses. What follows is a simple example to show why even modest rental increases are magnified into larger operating profits and healthy returns on investment over time. Suppose that you're in the market to purchase a single-family home that you want to rent out, and that such properties are selling for about $200,000 in the area you've deemed to be a good investment. Note: housing prices vary widely across different areas, but the following example should give you a relative sense of how a rental property's expenses and revenue change over time. You expect to make a 20% down payment and take out a 30-year fixed-rate mortgage at 6% for the remainder of the purchase price, $160,000. Here are the details. Monthly mortgage payment, $960. Monthly property tax, $200. Other monthly expenses, maintenance, insurance, $200. Monthly rent, $1,400. Table 1-1 explains what happens with your investment over time. We assume that your rent and expenses, except for your mortgage payment, which is fixed, increase 3% annually, and that your property appreciates a conservative 4% per year. For simplification purposes, we ignore depreciation in this example. If we had included the benefit of depreciation, it would further enhance the calculated investment returns. Now notice what happens over time. When you first buy the property, the monthly rent and the monthly expenses are about equal. By year 5, the monthly income exceeds the expenses by about $200 per month. Consider why this happens. Your largest monthly expense, the mortgage payment, doesn't increase. So, even though we assume that the rent increases just 3% per year, which is the same rate of increase assumed for your non-mortgage expenses, the compounding of rental inflation begins to produce larger and larger cash flows to you, the property owner. Cash flow of $200 per month may not sound like much, but consider that this $2,400 annual income is from an original $40,000 investment. Thus, by year 5, your rental property is producing a 6% return on your down payment investment. And remember, if you factor in the tax deduction for depreciation, your cash flow and return are even higher. In addition to the monthly cash flow from the amount that the rent exceeds the property's expenses, the last two columns in Table 1-1 reveal what has happened by year 5 to your equity, the difference between market value and mortgage balance owed in the property. With just a 4% annual increase in market value, your $40,000 in equity, the down payment, has more than doubled to $94,370, $243,330, minus $148,960. By years 10 and 20, you can see the further increases in your monthly cash flow and significant expansion in your property's equity. By year 30, the property is producing more than $1,400 per month cash flow, and you're now the proud owner of a mortgage-free property worth more than triple what you paid for it. After you get the mortgage paid off in year 30, consider what happens in year 31 and beyond to your monthly expenses. Big drop as your monthly mortgage payment disappears, and therefore your cash flow. Big increase. Recognizing the caveats of real estate investing. Despite all its potential, real estate investing isn't lucrative at all times and for all people. Here's a quick outline of the biggest caveats that accompany investing in real estate. Few home runs. Your likely returns from real estate won't approach the biggest home runs that the most accomplished entrepreneurs achieve in the business world. That said, by doing your homework, improving properties, and practicing good management, and sometimes enjoying a bit of luck, you can do extremely well. Warning: upfront operating profit challenges. Unless you make a large down payment, your monthly operating profit may be small, non-existent, or negative in the early years of rental property ownership. During soft periods in the local economy, rents may rise more slowly than your expenses, or they may even fall. That's why you must ensure that you can weather financially tough times. In the worst cases, we've seen rental property owners lose both their investment property and their homes. See the section, Fitting Real Estate into Your Plans, later in this chapter. Ups and downs. You're not going to earn an 8 to 10% return every year. Although you have the potential for significant profits, owning real estate isn't like owning a printing press at the U.S. Treasury. Like stocks and other types of ownership investments, real estate goes through down periods as well as up periods. Most people who make money investing in real estate do so because they invest and hold property over many years. Relatively high transaction costs. If you buy a property and then want out a year or two later, you may find that even though it has appreciated in value, much, if not all, of your profit has been wiped away by the high transaction costs. Typically, the costs of buying and selling, which include real estate agent commissions, loan fees, title insurance, and other closing costs, amount to about 8 to 12% of the purchase price of a property. So, although you may be elated if your property appreciates 10% in value in short order, you may not be so thrilled to realize that if you sell the property, you may not have any greater return than if you had stashed your money in a lowly bank account. Tax implications. Last but not least, when you make a positive net return or profit on your real estate investment, the federal and state governments are waiting with open hands for their share. Throughout this book, we highlight ways to improve your after-tax returns. As we stress more than once, the profit you have left over after government entities take their bites, not your pre-tax income, is what really matters. These drawbacks shouldn't keep you from exploring real estate investing as an option. Rather, they simply reinforce the need to really know what you're getting into with this type of investing and whether it's a good match for you. The rest of this chapter takes you deeper into an assessment of real estate as an investment, as well as introspection about your goals, interests, and abilities. Comparing real estate to other investments. Surely you've considered or heard about many different investments over the years. To help you grasp and understand the unique characteristics of real estate, we compare and contrast real estate's attributes with those of other wealth-building investments like stocks and small business. Returns. Clearly, a major reason that many people invest in real estate is for the healthy total returns, which include ongoing cash flow and the appreciation of the property. Real estate often generates robust long-term returns because, like stocks and small business, it's an ownership investment. By that, we mean that real estate is an asset that has the ability to produce periodic income and gains or profits upon refinancing or sale. Our research and experience suggest that total real estate investment returns are comparable to those from stocks, about 8 to 9% on average annually. Over recent decades, the average annual return on real estate investment trusts, REITs, publicly traded companies that invest in income-producing real estate, such as apartment buildings, office complexes, and shopping centers, has appreciated at about this pace as well. See our discussion of REITs in Chapter 4. And you can earn long-term returns that average much better than 10% per year if you select excellent properties in the best areas, hold them for several years, and manage them well. Risk. Real estate doesn't always rise in value. Witness the decline occurring in most parts of the U.S. during the late 2000s and early 2010s. That said, market values for real estate generally don't suffer from as much volatility as stock prices do. You may recall how the excitement surrounding the rapid, sustained increase of technology and internet stock prices in the late 1990s turned into the dismay and agony of those same sector stock prices crashing in the early 2000s. Many stocks in this industry, including those of leaders in their niches, saw their stock prices plummet by 80%, 90%, or more. Generally, you don't see those kinds of dramatic roller coaster shifts in values over the short run with the residential income property real estate market. However, keep in mind, especially if you tend to be concerned about shorter-term risks, that real estate can suffer from declines of 10%, 20%, or more. If you make a down payment of, say, 20% and want to sell your property after a 10 to 15% price decline, you may find that all, as in 100% of your invested dollars, down payment, are wiped out after you factor in transaction costs. So, you can lose everything. Remember, you can greatly reduce and minimize your risk investing in real estate through buying and holding property for many years, 7 to 10 or more. Remember that many of these fantastic success stories about amazing profits on flipping single-family homes and small rental properties are just like gamblers who only tell you about their biggest winnings, or forget to tell you that they turned around and lost much of what they won. While there is a lot of hype on cable television and the internet about flipping properties for crazy short-term profits, always think of real estate as a long-term investment. Liquidity. Liquidity, the ease and cost with which you can sell and get your money out of an investment, is one of real estate's shortcomings. Real estate is relatively illiquid. You can't sell a piece of property with the same speed with which you can whip out your ATM card and withdraw money from your bank account, or sell a stock or an exchange-traded fund with a click of your computer's mouse, or by tapping on your cell phone. Remember, we actually view real estate's relative illiquidity as a strength, certainly compared with stocks, that people often trade in and out of because doing so is easy and seemingly cheap. As a result, some stock market investors tend to lose sight of the long term and miss out on the bigger gains that accrue to patient, buy, and stick-with-it investors. Because you can't track the value of investment real estate daily on your computer, and because real estate takes considerable time, energy, and money to sell, you're far more likely to buy and hold on to your properties for the longer term. Although real estate investments are generally less liquid than stocks, they're generally more liquid than investments made in your own or someone else's small business. People need a place to live, and businesses need a place to operate. So there's always demand for real estate, although the supply of such available properties can greatly exceed the demand in some areas during certain time periods. Capital requirements. Although you can easily get started with traditional investments such as stocks and mutual funds with a few hundred or $1,000, the vast majority of quality real estate investments require far greater investments, usually on the order of tens of thousands of dollars. We devote an entire part of this book, Part 2, to be precise, to showing you how to raise capital and secure financing. Tip: if you're one of the many people who don't have that kind of money, don't despair. We present you with lower-cost real estate investment options. Among the simplest low-cost real estate investment options are real estate investment trusts, REITs. You can buy these as exchange-traded stocks or invest in a portfolio of REITs through a REIT mutual fund. See Chapter 4. Diversification value. An advantage of holding investment real estate is that its value doesn't necessarily move in tandem with other investments, such as stocks or small business investments that you hold. You may recall, for example, the massive stock market decline in the early 2000s. In most communities around America, real estate values were either steady or actually rising during this horrendous period for stock prices. However, real estate prices and stock prices, for example, can move down together in value. Witness the severe recession and stock market drop that took hold in 2008. Sluggish business conditions and lower corporate profits can depress stock and real estate prices. Opportunities to add value. Although you may not know much about investing in the stock market, you may have some good ideas about how to improve a property and make it more valuable. You can fix up a property or develop it further and raise the rental income accordingly. Perhaps through legwork, persistence, and good negotiating skills, you can purchase a property below its fair market value. Relative to investing in the stock market, tenacious and savvy real estate investors can more easily buy property in the private real estate market at below fair market value because the real estate market is somewhat less efficient and some owners don't realize the value of their income property or they need to sell quickly. Theoretically, you can do the same in the stock market, but the scores of professional, full-time money managers who analyze the public market for stocks make finding bargains more difficult. We help you identify properties that you can add value to in Part 3. Being aware of the tax advantages. Real estate investment offers numerous tax advantages. In this section, we compare and contrast investment property tax issues with those of other investments. Deductible expenses, including depreciation. Owning a property has much in common with owning your own small business. Every year, you account for your income and expenses on a tax return. We cover all the taxing points about investment properties in Chapter 18. For now, we want to remind you to keep good records of your expenses in purchasing and operating rental real estate. Check out Chapter 17 for more information on all things accounting. One expense that you get to deduct for rental real estate on your tax return, depreciation, doesn't actually involve spending or outlaying money. Depreciation is an allowable tax deduction for buildings because structures wear out over time. Under current tax laws, residential real estate is depreciated over 27 and a half years. Commercial buildings are less favored in the tax code and can be depreciated over 39 years. Residential real estate is depreciated over shorter time periods because it has traditionally been a favored investment in our nation's tax laws. Tax-free rollovers of rental property profits. When you sell a stock, mutual fund, or exchange-traded investment that you hold outside a retirement account, you must pay tax on your profits. By contrast, you can avoid paying tax on your profit when you sell a rental property if you roll over your gain into another like-kind investment real estate property. The rules for properly making one of these 1031 exchanges are complex and involve third parties. We cover 1031 exchanges in Chapter 18. Make sure that you find an attorney and/or tax advisor who is an expert at these transactions to ensure that you meet the technical and strict timing requirements so everything goes smoothly and legally. If you don't roll over your gain, you may owe significant taxes because of how the IRS defines your gain. For example, if you buy a property for $200,000 and sell it for $550,000, you not only owe tax on the gain from the increased property value, but you also owe tax on an additional amount, the property's depreciation you used during your ownership. The amount of depreciation that you deduct on your tax returns reduces the original $200,000 purchase price, making the taxable difference that much larger. For example, if you deducted $125,000 for depreciation over the years that you own the property, you owe tax on the difference between the sale price of $550,000 and $75,000. $200,000 purchase price minus $125,000 depreciation. Deferred taxes with installment sales. Installment sales are a complex method that can be used to defer your tax bill when you sell an investment property at a profit and you don't buy another rental property. With such a sale, you play the role of a banker and provide financing to the buyer. In addition to often collecting a competitive interest rate from the buyer, you only have to pay capital gains tax as you receive proceeds over time from the sale that are applied toward the principal or price the buyer agreed to pay for the property. For details, please see Chapter 18. Special tax credits for low-income housing and old buildings. If you invest in and upgrade low-income housing or certified historic buildings, you can gain special tax credits. The credits represent a direct reduction in your tax bill from expenditures to rehabilitate and improve such properties. These tax credits exist to encourage investors to invest in and fix up old or run-down buildings that likely would continue to deteriorate otherwise. The IRS has strict rules governing what types of properties qualify. See IRS Form 3468 to discover more about these tax credits. The 2017 Tax Cuts and Jobs Act bill created qualified opportunity zones to provide tax incentives to invest in low-income communities, which are defined by each state's governor and may comprise up to 25% of designated low-income communities in each state. States can also designate census tracts contiguous with low-income communities, so long as the median family income in those tracts doesn't exceed 125% of the qualifying contiguous low-income community. The new Qualified Opportunity Zone Tax Incentive allows real estate investors the following potential benefits. The capital gains tax due upon a sale of the property is deferred if the capital gain from the sale is reinvested within 180 days in a qualified opportunity fund. For investments in the qualified opportunity fund of at least 5 years, investors will receive a step-up in tax basis of 10% of the original gain. For investments in the qualified opportunity fund of at least 7 years, investors will receive an additional 5% step-up in tax basis. For investments of 10 or more years, or earlier than December 31, 2026, investors can exclude all capital gains of the investment. 20% qualified business income, QBI deduction for pass-through entities. The 2017 Tax Cuts and Jobs Act includes lower across-the-board federal income tax rates, which benefit all wage earners and investors, including real estate investors. If you spend at least 250 hours per year on certain activities, defined in a moment, related to your real estate investments, you may also be able to utilize an additional tax break targeted to certain small business entities. In redesigning the tax code, Congress realized that the many small businesses that operate as so-called pass-through entities would be subjected to higher federal income tax rates compared with the 21% corporate income tax rate, reduced from 35%. Pass-through entities are small businesses such as sole proprietorships, LLCs, partnerships, and S-corporations, and are so named because the profits of the business pass through to the owners and their personal income tax returns. To address the concern that individual business owners who operated their business as a pass-through entity could end up paying a higher tax rate than the 21% rate levied on C-corporations, Congress provided a 20% qualified business income, QBI, deduction for those businesses. So, for example, if your sole proprietorship netted you $60,000 in 2019 as a single taxpayer, that would push you into the 22% federal income tax bracket. But you get to deduct 20% of that $60,000 of income, or $12,000, so you would only owe federal income tax on the remaining $48,000. $60,000 minus $12,000. This deduction effectively reduces the 22% tax bracket to 17.6%. This 20% pass-through QBI deduction gets phased out for service business owners. For example, lawyers, doctors, real estate agents, consultants, and so on. At single taxpayer incomes above $157,500, up to $207,500. And for married couples filing jointly, incomes over $315,000, up to $415,000. For other types of businesses above these income thresholds, this deduction may be limited, so consult with your tax advisor. The Internal Revenue Service has clarified that certain rental real estate investor entities are eligible for the QBI 20% pass-through deduction in a given tax year, if the following conditions are met. Separate books and records are maintained to reflect income and expenses for each rental real estate enterprise. For tax years 2022 and earlier, 250 or more hours of rental services are performed, as described in this revenue procedure, per year with respect to the rental enterprise. For tax 2023 and beyond, in any three of the five consecutive taxable years that end with the taxable year, or in each year for an enterprise held for less than 5 years, 250 or more hours of rental services are performed, as described in this revenue procedure, per year with respect to the rental real estate enterprise. The taxpayer maintains contemporaneous records, including time reports, logs, or similar documents, regarding the following: hours of all services performed, descriptions of all services performed, dates on which such services were performed, who performed the services. Such records are to be made available for inspection at the request of the IRS. The contemporaneous records requirement will not apply to taxable years prior to 2019. Per the Internal Revenue Service, rental services include the following: advertising to rent or lease the real estate, negotiating and executing leases, verifying information contained in prospective tenant applications, collection of rent, daily operation, maintenance, and repair of the property, management of the real estate, purchase of materials, supervision of employees and independent contractors. Rental services may be performed by owners or by employees, agents, and/or independent contractors of the owners. The term rental services does not include financial or investment management activities, such as arranging financing, procuring property, studying and reviewing financial statements or reports on operations, planning, managing, or constructing long-term capital improvements, or time spent traveling to and from the real estate. Real estate used by the taxpayer, including an owner or beneficiary of a relevant pass-through entity, as a residence for any part of the year, is not eligible for this tax break. Real estate rented or leased under a triple net lease is also not eligible for the QBI deduction. Tip: tax advisor Vern Hoven suggests that you can easily avoid the triple net lease exclusion by changing the terms of the lease to a net lease, in which the landlord makes the payments for both the real estate property taxes and insurance. So that the financial terms of the original lease remain the same, the landlord then increases the amount of the rent paid by the tenant to offset that full amount of taxes and insurance now paid by the landlord. Thus, your triple net lease becomes a net lease with the same net effective financial terms, but qualifies for the 20% QBI deduction. Determining whether you should invest in real estate. We believe that most people can succeed at investing in real estate if they're willing to do their homework, which includes selecting top real estate professionals. In the sections that follow, we ask several important questions to help you decide whether you have what it takes to succeed and be happy with real estate investments that involve managing property. Income-producing real estate isn't a passive investment. Do you have sufficient time? Purchasing and owning investment real estate and being a landlord are time-consuming, the same way an uninformed owner can sell his property for less than it's worth. If you fail to do your homework before purchasing property, you can end up overpaying or buying real estate with a slew of problems. Finding competent and ethical real estate professionals takes time. We guide you through the process in Chapter 6. Investigating communities, neighborhoods, and zoning also soaks up plenty of hours. Information on performing this research is located in Chapter 10, as does examining tenant issues with potential properties. See Chapter 11. As for managing a property, you can hire a property manager to interview tenants, collect the rent, and solve problems such as leaky faucets and broken appliances. But doing so costs money and still requires some of your time. Of course, if you hire a competent and experienced property manager, you will be rewarded with less time required for oversight. Tip: if you're stretched too thin due to work and family responsibilities, real estate investing may not be for you. So, unless you want to locate, interview, hire, and pay for a qualified property manager, then you may want to look into the less time-intensive real estate investments discussed in Chapters 3 and 4. Can you deal with problems? Challenges and problems inevitably occur when you try to buy a property. Purchase negotiations can be stressful and frustrating. You can also count on some problems coming up when you own and manage investment real estate. Most tenants won't care for a property the way property owners do. If every little problem, especially those that you think may have been caused by your tenants, think bed bugs, causes you distress, at a minimum, you should only own rental property with the assistance of a property manager. You should also question whether you're really going to be satisfied owning investment property. The financial rewards come well down the road, but you live the day-to-day ownership headaches, including the risk of litigation, immediately. Does real estate interest you? In our experience, some of the best real estate investors have a curiosity and interest in real estate. If you don't already possess it, such an interest and curiosity can be cultivated, and this book may just do the trick. On the other hand, some people simply aren't comfortable investing in rental property. For example, if you've had experience and success with stock market investing, you may be uncomfortable venturing into real estate investments. Some people we know are on a mission to start their own business and may prefer to channel the time and money into that outlet. Can you handle market downturns? Real estate investing isn't for the faint of heart. Buying and holding real estate is a whole lot of fun when prices and rents are rising. But market downturns happen, and they test you emotionally as well as financially. Consider the real estate market price declines that happened in most communities and types of property surrounding the 2008 financial crisis. In many parts of the country, the impact was still a reality several years later. Such drops can present attractive buying opportunities for those with courage, a good credit score, and cash for the down payment. None of us has a crystal ball, though, so don't expect to be able to buy at the precise bottom of prices and sell at an exact peak of your local market. Even if you make a smart buy now, you'll inevitably end up holding some of your investment property during a difficult market, recessions where you have trouble finding and retaining quality tenants, where rents and property values may fall rather than rise. Do you have the financial and emotional wherewithal to handle such a downturn? How have you handled other investments when their values have fallen? Fitting real estate into your plans. For most non-wealthy people, purchasing investment real estate has a major impact on their overall personal financial situation. So, before you go out to buy property, you should inventory your money life and be sure your fiscal house is in order. This section explains how you can do just that. Ensuring your best personal financial health. If you're trying to improve your physical fitness by exercising, you may find that eating lots of junk food and smoking are barriers to your goal. Likewise, investing in real estate or other growth investments, such as stocks, while you're carrying high-cost consumer debt, credit cards, auto loans, and so on, and spending more than you earn impedes your financial goals. Tip: before you set out to invest in real estate, pay off all your consumer debt. Not only will you be financially healthier for doing so, but you'll also enhance your future mortgage applications. Eliminate wasteful and unnecessary spending. Analyze your monthly spending to identify target areas for reduction. This practice enables you to save more and better afford making investments, including real estate. Robert's and Eric's parents also taught the importance of living below your means. However, this takes a lot of discipline and self-control in the face of our consumer-driven, must-have world, in which having the latest technology or keeping up with the influencers is how some people define their success. As Charles Dickens said, annual income, £20. Annual expenditures, £19. Result, happiness. Annual income, £20. Annual expenditure, £20. Result, misery. Protecting yourself with insurance. Regardless of your real estate investment desires and decisions, you absolutely must have comprehensive insurance for yourself and your major assets, including health insurance. Major medical coverage protects you from financial ruin if you have a major accident or illness that requires significant hospital and other medical care. Disability insurance. For most working people, their biggest asset is their future income-earning ability. Disability insurance replaces a portion of your employment earnings if you're unable to work for an extended period of time due to an incapacitating illness or injury. Life insurance. If loved ones are financially dependent upon you, term life insurance, which provides a lump sum death benefit, can help to replace your employment earnings if you pass away. Homeowners insurance. Not only do you want homeowners insurance to protect you against the financial cost due to a fire or other home-damaging catastrophe, but such coverage also provides you with liability protection. After you buy and operate a rental property with tenants, you should obtain rental owner's insurance. See Chapter 16 for more information. Auto insurance. This coverage is similar to homeowner's coverage in that it insures a valuable asset and also provides liability insurance should you be involved in an accident. Excess liability, umbrella insurance. This relatively inexpensive coverage, available in million-dollar increments, adds on to the modest liability protection offered on your basic home and auto policies, which is inadequate for more affluent people. Nobody enjoys spending hard-earned money on insurance. However, having proper protection gives you peace of mind and financial security. so don't put off reviewing and securing needed policies. For assistance, see the latest edition of Eric's Personal Finance for Dummies, Wiley. Considering retirement account funding. If you're not taking advantage of your retirement accounts, such as 401ks, 403bs, SEP IRAs, and so on, you may be missing out on some terrific tax benefits. Funding retirement accounts gives you an immediate tax deduction when you contribute to them. And some employer accounts offer free matching money. But you've got to contribute to earn the matching money. In comparison, you derive no tax benefits while you accumulate your down payment for an investment real estate purchase, or other investments such as for a small business. Furthermore, the operating positive cash flow or income from your real estate investment is subject to ordinary income taxes as you earn it. To be fair and balanced, we must mention here that investment real estate offers numerous tax benefits, which we detail in the Being Aware of the Tax Advantages section earlier in this chapter. Thinking about asset allocation. With money that you invest for the longer term, you should have an overall game plan in mind. Fancy-talking financial advisors like to use buzzwords such as asset allocation, a term that indicates what portion of your money you have invested in different types of investment vehicles, such as stocks and real estate, for appreciation or growth, versus lending vehicles, such as bonds and certificates of deposit, also known as CDs, which produce current income. Tip: here's a simple way to calculate asset allocation for long-term investments. Subtract your age from 110. The result is the percentage of your long-term money that you should invest in ownership investments for appreciation. So, for example, a 40-year-old would take 110 minus 40 equals 70% in growth investments, such as stocks and real estate. If you want to be more aggressive, subtract your age from 120. A 40-year-old would then have 80% in growth investments. As you gain more knowledge, assets, and diversification of growth assets, you're in a better position to take on more risk. Just be sure you're properly covered with insurance, as discussed earlier in the section, Protecting Yourself with Insurance. Remember, these are simply guidelines, not hard and fast rules or mandates. If you want to be more aggressive and are comfortable taking on greater risk, you can invest higher portions in ownership investments. As you consider asset allocation, when classifying your investments, determine and use your equity in your real estate holdings, which is the market value of property less outstanding mortgages. For example, suppose that prior to buying an investment property, your long-term investments consist of the following: stocks, $150,000, bonds, $50,000, CDs, $50,000, total, $250,000. How leverage affects your real estate returns. Real estate is different from most other investments in that you can typically borrow, finance, up to 70 to 80% or more of the value of the property. Thus, you can use your small down payment of 20 to 30% of the purchase price to buy, own, and control a much larger investment. During market downturns, lenders tighten requirements and may require larger down payments than they do during good times. So when your real estate increases in value, which is what you hope and expect, you make money on your investment as well as on the money that you borrowed. That's what we mean when we say that the investment returns from real estate are enhanced due to leverage. Consider this simple example. Suppose you purchase a property for $150,000 and make a $30,000 down payment. Over the next 3 years, imagine that the property appreciates 10% to $165,000. Thus, you have a profit, on paper, of $15,000. $165,000 versus $150,000 on an investment of just $30,000. In other words, you've made a 50% return on your investment. Note: we ignore cash flow, whether your rental income that you collect from the property exceeds the expenses that you pay or vice versa, and the tax benefits associated with rental real estate. Remember, leverage magnifies all of your returns, and those returns aren't always positive. If your $150,000 property decreases in value to $135,000, even though it has only dropped 10% in value, you actually lose, on paper, 50% of your original $30,000 investment. in case you care, and it's okay if you don't. Some wonks apply the terms positive leverage and negative leverage. Please see the Understanding Real Estate's Income and Wealth-Producing Potential section earlier in this chapter for a more detailed example of investment property profit and return. So, you have 60% in ownership investments, $150,000, and 40% in lending investments, $50,000 plus $50,000. Now, suppose you plan to purchase a $300,000 income property, making a $75,000 down payment. Because you've decided to bump up your ownership investment portion to make your money grow more over the years, you plan to use your maturing CD balance and sell some of your bonds for the down payment. After your real estate purchase, here's how your investment portfolio sounds. Stocks, $150,000. Real estate, $75,000. $300,000 property, minus $225,000 mortgage. Bonds, $25,000. Total, $250,000. Thus, after the real estate purchase, you've got 90% in ownership investments, $150,000 plus $75,000, and just 10% in lending investments, $25,000. Such a mix may be appropriate for someone under the age of 50 who desires an aggressive investment portfolio positioned for long-term growth potential. Become your own landlord. Many real estate investors are actually involved in other activities as their primary source of income. Ironically, many of these business owners come to realize the benefits of real estate investing, but miss the single greatest opportunity that is right before their eyes: the prospect of being their own landlord. Robert has advised many business owners that they should purchase the buildings occupied by their own businesses and essentially pay the rent to themselves. If you own a business that rents, do yourself a favor. Consider becoming your own landlord. Refer to Chapter 15 for more information. Chapter 2. Covering Common Real Estate Investments. In this chapter, keeping your investments close to home, looking at residential properties, getting to know commercial real estate, studying undeveloped land. If you lack substantial experience investing in real estate, you should avoid more esoteric and complicated properties and strategies. In this chapter, we discuss the more accessible and easy-to-master income-producing property options. In particular, residential income property, which we discuss in the next section, can be an attractive real estate investment for many people. Residential housing is easier to understand, purchase, and manage, such as office, industrial, and retail property. If you're a homeowner, you already have experience locating, purchasing, and maintaining residential property. In addition to discussing the pros and cons of investing in residential income property, we add insights as to which may be the most appropriate and profitable for you, and touch on the topics of investing in commercial property as well as undeveloped land. Identifying the various ways to invest in residential income property. The first and one of the best real estate investments for many people is a home in which to live. In this section, we cover the investment possibilities inherent in buying a home for your own use, including potential profit to be had from converting your home to a rental or fixing it up and selling it. We also give you some pointers on how to profit from owning your own vacation home. Buying a place of your own. During your adult life, you're going to need a roof over your head for many decades, and real estate is the only investment that you can live in or rent out to produce income. A stock, bond, or mutual fund doesn't work too well as a roof over your head. Remember, unless you expect to move within the next few years, buying a place may make good long-term financial sense. Even if you need to relocate, you may decide to continue owning the property and use it as a rental property. In most real estate markets, owning usually costs less than renting over the long haul, and allows you to build equity, the dollar difference between market value and the current balance of the mortgage loans against the property, in an asset. Under current tax law, you can also pocket substantial tax-free profits when you sell your home for more than you originally paid, plus the money you sunk into improvements during your ownership. Specifically, single taxpayers can realize up to a $250,000 tax-free capital gain, Married couples filing jointly get up to $500,000. In order to qualify for this homeowner's gains tax exemption, you or your spouse, if you're married, must have owned the home and used it as your primary residence for a minimum of 24 months out of the past 60 months. The 24 months don't have to be continuous. Additionally, this tax break allows for pro rata, proportionate credit, based on hardship or change of employment. Also note that the full exemption amounts are reduced proportionally for the length of time you rented out your home over the 5-year period referenced earlier. Some commentators have stated that your home isn't an investment because you're not renting it out. We respectfully disagree. Consider the fact that some people move to a less costly home when they retire, because it's smaller and/or because it's in a lower cost area. Trading down to a lower priced property in retirement frees up equity that has built up over many years of home ownership. This money can be used to supplement your retirement income and for any other purpose your heart desires. Your home is an investment because it can appreciate in value over the years, and you can use that money toward your financial or personal goals. The most recent version of Home Buying for Dummies, Wiley, which Eric co-wrote with residential real estate expert Ray Brown, can help you make terrific home buying decisions. Converting your home to a rental. Turning your current home into a rental property when you move is a simple way to buy and own more properties. You can do this multiple times as you move out of homes you own over the years, and you can do this strategy of acquiring rental properties not only with a house, but also with a duplex or other small multi-unit rental property where you reside in one of the units. This approach is an option if you're already considering investing in real estate, either now or in the future, and you can afford to own two or more properties. Holding on to your current home when you're buying a new one is more advisable if you're moving within the same area, so that you're close by to manage the property. This approach presents a number of positives. You save the time and cost of finding a separate rental property, not to mention the associated transaction costs. You know the property and have probably taken good care of it and perhaps made some improvements. You know the target market because the home appealed to you. Warning: some people unfortunately make the mistake of holding on to their current home for the wrong reasons when they buy another. This situation typically occurs when a homeowner must sell their home in a depressed market. Nobody likes to lose money and sell their home for less than they paid for it, or sell for a good deal less than it was worth several years ago. Thus, some owners hold on to their homes until prices recover. If you plan to move and want to keep your current home as a long-term investment rental property, you can. If you fully convert your home to rental property and use it that way for years before selling it, after you do sell, you can either take advantage of the lower long-term capital gains rates or do a tax-deferred exchange. For tax purposes, you get to deduct depreciation and all the write-offs during the ownership, and you can shelter up to $25,000 in income from active sources subject to income eligibility requirements, or even more if you or your spouse happen to qualify as a real estate professional. Please see Chapter 18 for more details. Turning your home into a short-term rental, however, is usually a bad move because you may not want the responsibilities of being a landlord, yet you force yourself into the landlord business when you convert your home into a rental. You owe tax on the sale's profit and recaptured depreciation if your property is classified for tax purposes as a rental when you sell it, and you don't buy another rental property. You can purchase another rental property through a 1031 exchange to defer paying taxes on your profit. See the discussion in Chapter 18. Remember, you lose some of the capital gains tax exclusion if you sell your home and you had rented it out for a portion of the 5-year period prior to selling it. For example, if you rented your home for 2 of the last 5 years, you may only exclude 60% of your gain, up to the maximums of $250,000 for single taxpayers and $500,000 for married couples filing jointly, whereas the other 40% is taxed as a long-term capital gain. Also be aware that when you sell a home previously rented and are accounting for the sale on your tax return, you must recapture the depreciation taken during the rental period. Investing and living in well-situated fixer-uppers. Serial home selling is a variation on the tried-and-true real estate investment strategy of investing in well-located fixer-upper homes where you can invest your time, sweat equity, and materials to make improvements that add more value than they cost. The only catch is that you must actually move into the fixer-upper for at least 24 months to earn the full homeowner's capital gains exemption of up to $250,000 for single taxpayers and $500,000 for married couples filing jointly, as we cover in the Buying a Place of Your Own section earlier in this chapter. Remember, be sure to buy a home in need of that special TLC in a great neighborhood where you're willing to live for 24 months or more. But if you're a savvy investor, you would have invested in a great neighborhood anyway. Here's a simple example to illustrate the potentially significant benefits of this strategy. You purchase a fixer-upper for $275,000 that becomes your principal residence. And then over the next 24 months, you invest $25,000 in improvements. Paint, repairs, landscaping, appliances, decorator items, and so on. And you also invest the amount of sweat equity that suits your skills and wallet. You now have one of the nicer homes in the neighborhood, and you can sell this home for a net price of $400,000 after your transaction costs. With your total investment of $300,000, $275,000 plus $25,000, your efforts have earned you a $100,000 profit completely tax-free. Thus, you've earned an average of $50,000 per year, which isn't bad for a tax-exempt second income without strict office hours. Note that many states also allow you to avoid state income taxes on the sale of your personal residence, using many of the same requirements as the federal tax laws. Warning. Now, some cautions are in order here. This strategy is clearly not for everyone interested in making money from real estate investments. In our experience, this strategy is not likely to work well for you if any of the following apply. You're unwilling or reluctant to live through redecorating, minor remodeling, or major construction. You dislike having to move every few years. You're not experienced or comfortable with identifying undervalued property and improving it. You lack a financial cushion to withstand a significant downturn in your local real estate market, as happened in numerous parts of the country during the late 2000s and early 2010s. You don't have the budget to hire a professional, licensed, and insured contractor to do the work. And you don't have the free time or the home improvement skills needed to enhance the value of a home. Warning. One final caution. Beware of transaction costs. The expenses involved with buying and selling property, such as real estate agent commissions, loan fees, title insurance, escrow or closing costs, and so forth, can gobble up a large portion of your profits. With most properties, the long-term appreciation is what drives your returns. Consider keeping homes you buy and improve as long-term investment properties. Purchasing a vacation home. Many people of means expand their real estate holdings by purchasing a vacation home, a home in an area where they enjoy taking pleasure trips. For most people, buying a vacation home is more of a consumption decision than it is an investment decision. However, potential investment returns shouldn't be the main reason you buy a second home. For example, we know a family that lived in Pennsylvania and didn't particularly like the hot and humid summer weather. They enjoyed taking trips and staying in various spots in northern New England, and eventually bought a small home in New Hampshire. Their situation highlights the pros and cons that many people face with vacation or second homes. The obvious advantage this family enjoyed in having a vacation home is that they no longer had the hassle of securing accommodations when they wanted to enjoy some downtime. Also, after they arrived at their home away from home, they were, well, home. Things were just as they expected, with no surprises, unless squirrels had taken up residence on their porch. Warning. The downsides to vacation homes can be numerous, as our Pennsylvania friends found, including expenses. With a second home, you have the range of nearly all the costs of a primary home. Mortgage interest, property taxes, insurance, repairs and maintenance, utilities, and so on. Property management. When you're not at your vacation home, things can go wrong. A pipe can burst, for example, and the mess may not be found for days or weeks. Unless the property is close to a good neighbor or other kind of person willing to keep an eye on it for you, you may incur the additional expense of paying a property manager to watch the property for you. Lack of rental income. most people don't rent out their vacation homes, thus negating the investment property income stream that contributes to the returns real estate investors enjoy. See Chapter 1. If your second home is in a vacation area where you have access to plenty of short-term renters, you or your designated property manager can rent out the property. Note that using a service like Airbnb assists with finding people to rent your property, but doesn't help with the arrival or departure and security deposit issues, nor applicant screening and keeping your property maintained, plus many other similar services a property manager performs. However, this entails all the headaches and hassles of having many short-term renters. But you do gain the tax advantages of depreciation and all expenses as with other rental properties. Obligation to use. Some second homeowners we know complain about feeling obliged to use their vacation homes. Oftentimes in marriages, one spouse likes the vacation home much more than the other spouse, or one spouse enjoys working on the second home rather than enjoying the home itself. Before we close out this section on vacation homes, we want to share a few tax tips as found in the current tax code. If you retain your vacation home or secondary home as personal property, foregoing the large income streams and tax write-offs for depreciation and operating expenses associated with rental properties, you can still make a nice little chunk of tax-free cash on the side. The current tax code permits you to rent the property for up to 14 days a year, and that income is tax-free. You don't have to claim it. Yes, you heard that right, and you can still deduct the costs of ownership, including mortgage interest and property taxes, as you do for all other personal properties. If you decide to maintain the property as a rental, you rent it out for more than 14 days a year, you, as the property owner, can still use the rental property as a vacation home for up to 14 days a year, or a maximum of 10% of the days gainfully rented, whichever is greater, and the property still qualifies as a rental. Also, all days spent cleaning or repairing the rental home don't count as personal use days, so that's why you paint for a couple of hours every afternoon and spend the morning fishing. Before you buy a second home, weigh all the pros and cons. If you have a partner with whom you're buying the property, have a candid discussion. Also, consult with your tax advisor for other tax-saving strategies for your second home or vacation home. And please see Chapter 18 for more tax-related information on rental properties. Paying for timeshares and condo hotels. Timeshares, a concept created in the 1960s, are a form of ownership or right to use a property. A more recent trend in real estate investing is condo hotels, which in many ways are simply a new angle on the old concept of timeshares. A condo hotel looks and operates just like any other first-class hotel, with the difference that each room is separately owned. The hotel guests, renters, have no idea who owns their room. Both timeshares and condo hotels typically involve luxury resort locations with amenities such as golf or spas. The difference between the traditional timeshare and condo hotel is the interval that the unit is available. Condo hotels are operated on a day-to-day availability, and timeshares typically rent in fixed intervals such as weeks. Some of the most popular projects have been the branded condo hotels such as Ritz-Carlton, Four Seasons, Trump, W, Westin, and Hilton, located in high-profile vacation destinations like Hawaii, Las Vegas, New York, Chicago, and Miami. You can also find many foreign condo hotel properties in the Caribbean and Mexico, and the concept is expanding to Europe, the Middle East, and Asia. Two types of individuals are attracted to investing in condo hotels and timeshares. One group is investors who believe that the property will appreciate like any other investment. The other group is people who use the condo hotel or timeshare for personal use and offset some of their costs. We don't see timeshares or condo hotels as worthy real estate investments, as they don't appreciate and they don't generate income. But they are often presented as a viable alternative real estate investment, and millions have been purchased. You will likely be solicited to consider this opportunity during an upcoming vacation. So, we want to share our concerns. Taming timeshares. Timeshares are offered as deeded and non-deeded timeshares. With deeded timeshares, you own a permanent or fee simple interest. And with non-deeded timeshares, you have a right to use the property, but there is an expiration date. See the sidebar, Still interested in a timeshare? Listen on. For more info on the types of timeshare ownership, the most popular timeshares are deeded, and they can be sold or transferred just like any other interest in real estate, assuming there is demand. Many investors' first experiences with timeshares are tempting offers of a free meal, a great discount offer to a theme park, or even a free one- or two-night stay at the resort, with the catch that they have to spend some time listening to an informational presentation. These offers usually come from individuals contacting you in known tourist locations, or when you check into a hotel that just happens to offer condos as well. Robert remembers his first exposure to timeshares was as a child in the early 70s, on a family vacation to Florida, when his parents got a free camera just for attending a seminar on timeshares near Orlando. Even as a teenager, Robert didn't like the obvious pressure sales tactics he observed. From an investment standpoint, the fundamental problem with timeshares is that they're overpriced. And, like a condominium, you own no land, which is what generally appreciates well over time. For example, suppose that a particular unit would cost $150,000 to buy. When this unit is carved up into weekly ownership units, the total cost of all those units can easily approach 4 to 5 times that amount. Now you understand why timeshare developers and promoters can give you free stuff if you will listen to their sales pitch. Their profit margins are very high on every sale. To add insult to injury, investors find that another problem with timeshares is the high management fees or service fees and almost guaranteed rising annual maintenance fees over time. As the property gets older, the annual maintenance costs, which you are required to pay to retain ownership of your timeshare interval, continue to increase and can even exceed what you would pay for a comparable stay at a nearby non-timeshare. Is it worth buying a slice of real estate at a 400 to 500% premium to its fair market value and paying high ongoing maintenance fees on top of that? We don't think so. Many owners of timeshares find that they want to vacation at a different location or time of year than what they originally purchased. To meet this need, several companies offer to broker or sell or trade timeshare slots for a fee. However, timeshare availability and desirability have so many variables, including location, time of year, amenities, and quality of the particular resort, that it has been difficult to fairly value and trade timeshares. For a given resort, it can be difficult online to determine which of two identical floor plan units has the prime location versus a less desirable one. As a result, resort rating systems have been developed. Resorts Condominiums International, RCI, and Interval International are two of the most well-known, to compare resort location, amenities, and quality. Remember, however, timeshares may make sense for you if you like to vacation at the same resort around the same time every year, and if the annual service or maintenance fees compare favorably to the cost of simply staying in a comparable resort. Remember, though, that if the deal seems too good to be true, it is too good to be true. The only folks who generally make money with timeshares and condo hotels are the developers, not the folks who buy specific days of ownership. Still interested in a timeshare? Listen on. Timeshares are packaged in a multitude of ways. Some resorts offer fixed units, where you vacation at the exact same unit every year, either on set dates or set numbered weeks, though the actual calendar date may vary. Other timeshares are available biennially, every other year, so you can have some variety. Some offer fixed weeks, where you have the same week every year, but maybe in a different unit. Timeshares aren't just a one-time purchase. They also have monthly or annual service or maintenance fees. These funds are established each year by the homeowners association or resort management company. There are different types of ownership for timeshare interests, with fee simple, right of use, and leasehold being the primary options. Fee simple, or deeded ownership, is a fee simple estate in real estate that provides the absolute ownership subject to state and local laws and government powers, such as taxation, eminent domain, police power, and so on. Right to use, or non-deeded ownership, provides occupancy rights for a given number of years, but no actual ownership interest in the property. Some states and many foreign countries don't allow the fee simple ownership of timeshares, So they offer long-term lease or right-to-use agreements that can be from 20 to 99 years. The actual fee simple title of the real estate remains with the resort developer or management company. A homeowners association or a resort management company typically handles the day-to-day operations of timeshares, and you have the same type of service or annual management and maintenance fees. Leasehold is an agreement between the lessee, tenant, and lessor, owner or landlord, specifying the lessee's right to use the leased property for a given purpose and given time at a specified rental payment. If you're interested in buying a timeshare, know that timeshare owners are required by law to disclose their full audited financials. Read them carefully. You can talk with the developer directly. This method may make sense if you're looking for a particular time of the year in the high season. The timeshare industry typically uses a color-coded pricing system to denote the seasonal demand for a particular timeshare property. Although the concept is pretty consistent, the designation of dates for each particular color can vary from one resort to another. In general, the demand is broken down into three categories: red for the prime or high demand, yellow or white for intermediate or medium season, green or blue for off-season or low demand. If you're looking for a week in the green or blue season, you can often find much better pricing from reputable resellers. Reputable is a key and elusive term here. Among companies to consider for reselling timeshares are RCI, Interval International, and Trading Places International. Remember, a cottage industry for timeshare cancellations has sprouted up, and undoubtedly you have seen or will soon see or hear an ad for a company that is offering to assist you in canceling or getting rid of your timeshare. The demand for these services is increasing, as many timeshare properties are aging and the maintenance fees are rising, often to the point that it is more expensive to stay at your own timeshare than to simply pay for a comparable rental, possibly at a much newer and more luxurious resort property in the same area. The timeshare cancellation strategies often involve either selling your timeshare, almost always at a significant or even a complete loss, attempting to rescind the timeshare, virtually impossible unless you just bought it while on vacation early this week and are still within the cooling off or rescission period, asking the developer to just take it back. Most won't, but rarely one actually will. Renting out or gifting your interval, or hiring an attorney who may be able to find a legitimate way to challenge the disclosures or the validity of the timeshare contract. Timeshare laws vary greatly from state to state, so you want to find a timeshare cancellation company or attorney that specializes in canceling timeshares in the state where your timeshare is located. While you will take a large financial hit when you sell or cancel your timeshare, you need to consider that the benefits of cutting your future losses, maintenance fees, may make such a tough decision the right one. Coping with condo hotels. The developers and operators of condo hotels love the concept because one of the most consistently successful principles of real estate is increasing value by fractionalizing interests in real estate. As with timeshares, the developers are able to sell each individual hotel room for much more than they could get for the entire project. Condo hotel operators are able to generate additional revenue from service and maintenance fees to cover their costs of operations. Often, the owner's use of their own rooms doesn't negatively impact the overall revenues of the property, because the rooms would have sometimes been vacant anyway. Condo hotels allow their owners to stay in their units, but often impose limits on the amount of personal usage. There may also be resort fees, parking fees, or other amenity costs as well. The purchaser of the condo hotel unit sees this type of investment as an option to direct ownership of a second home and likes the ability to generate income. The professional management is another one of the attractions to investors. The owners don't pay a management fee to the hotel operator unless their room is rented, and then the collected revenue is split, typically in the 50-50 range, and the operator has complete control over the rental rate, as well as which units are rented each day. These properties are often hyped, and the expectations of the condo hotel investor are often much greater than the reality. Investors are lured to condo hotels by the potential for appreciation and cash flow, as well as professional management. Many investors find themselves being pressured into pre-sale offering presentations even before the units are built. These events can be tempting, but savvy investors need to do their own due diligence. So when you hear a sales pitch indicating that your proposed investment in a condo hotel unit will provide significant income from hotel rentals and cover most or all of your mortgage and carrying costs, that's the time to grab your wallet and find the nearest exit. True story. Besides being a real estate investor and property manager, Robert is routinely hired to be an expert witness in litigation matters. One area of expertise he has is with condo hotels, and he has been involved as the expert in condo hotel litigation in Hawaii, Las Vegas, Big Sky Resort, Park City, Jackson Hole, and several other popular vacation destinations. The typical lawsuit involves allegations by the unit owners that the developer or operator of the condo hotel overpromised occupancy rates and revenues, understated expenses, and even removed and downgraded some of the resort features or amenities. At one well-known Las Vegas resort, condo hotel unit owners found that a large section of the common area pool deck had been reconfigured to cabanas with high-margin alcohol bottle sales. Residents could still use the pool. But what was presented during the condo hotel sales period as an amazing, expansive, and impressive resort-style pool was reduced for unit owners to nothing spectacular at all, and they had no recourse over the loss of one of the most attractive amenities that contributed to their investment decision. Surveying the types of residential properties you can buy. If you've been in the market for a home, you know that in addition to single-family homes, you can choose from numerous types of attached or shared housing, including duplexes, triplexes, apartment buildings, condominiums, townhomes, and cooperatives. In this section, we provide an overview of each of these properties and show you how they may make an attractive real estate investment for you. Tip: from an investment perspective, our top recommendations are apartment buildings and single-family homes. We generally don't recommend attached housing units, which have associations and shared common areas. If you can afford a smaller single-family home or apartment building rather than a shared housing unit, buy the single-family home or apartments. Warning: unless you can afford a large down payment, 25% or more, the early years of rental property ownership may financially challenge you. With all properties, as time goes on, generating a positive cash flow gets easier because your mortgage expense stays fixed if you use fixed-rate financing, while your rents increase faster than your expenses, unless you are in a rent-controlled area. Regardless of what you choose to buy, make sure that you run the numbers on your rental income and expenses. See Chapter 12 to see if you can afford the negative cash flow that often occurs in the early years of ownership, and always allow for unexpected vacancy or capital improvements like flooring and window coverings, appliances, and/or the water heater. Single-family homes. As an investment, single-family detached homes generally perform better in the long run than attached or shared housing. In a good real estate market, most housing appreciates, but single-family homes tend to outperform other housing types for the following reasons. Single-family homes tend to attract more potential buyers. Most people, when they can afford it, prefer a detached or standalone home, especially for the increased privacy and less noise from neighbors. Attached or shared housing is less expensive and easier to build and to overbuild. Because of this surplus potential, such property tends to appreciate more moderately in price. Investigate. Because so many people prefer to live in detached, single-family homes, market prices for such dwellings can often become inflated beyond what's justified by the rental income these homes can produce. That's exactly what happened in some parts of the United States in the mid-2000s and led, in part, to a significant price correction in the subsequent years. To discover whether you're buying in such a market, compare the monthly cost, after tax, of owning a home to the monthly rent for that same property. Focus on markets where the rent exceeds or comes close to equaling the cost of owning, and shun areas where the ownership costs exceed rents. Single-family homes that require just one tenant are simpler to deal with than a multi-unit apartment building that requires the management and maintenance of multiple renters and units. The downside, though, is that a vacancy means you have no income coming in. Look at the effect of 0% occupancy for a couple of months on your projected income and expense statement. By contrast, one vacancy in a four-unit apartment building, each with the same rents, means that you're still taking in 75% of the gross potential, maximum total rent. With a single-family home, you're responsible for all repairs and maintenance. You can hire someone to do the work, but you still have to find the contractors and coordinate and oversee the work. Also recognize that if you purchase a single-family home with many fine features and amenities, you may find it more stressful and difficult to have tenants living in your property who don't treat it with the same tender loving care that you may yourself. Tip: the first rule of being a successful landlord is to let go of any emotional attachment to a home. But that sort of attachment on the tenant's part is favorable. The more they make your rental property their home, the more likely they are to stay and return it to you in good condition, except for the expected normal wear and tear of day-to-day living. We discuss the proper screening and selection of tenants in Chapter 15. Remember, making a profit in the early years of ownership from the monthly cash flow with a single-family home is generally the hardest stage. The reason? Such properties usually sell at a premium price relative to the rent that they can command. You pay extra for the land, which you can't rent. Also remember that with just one tenant, you have no rental income when you have a vacancy. Attached housing. As the cost of land has climbed over the decades in many areas, packing more housing units that are attached into a given plot of land keeps housing somewhat more affordable. Shared housing makes sense for investors who don't want to deal with building maintenance and security issues. In this section, we discuss the investment merits of three forms of attached housing: condominiums, townhomes, and co-ops. Condos. Condominiums are typically apartment-style units stacked on top of and/or beside one another and sold to individual owners. When you purchase a condominium, you're actually purchasing the interior of a specific unit, as well as a proportionate, undivided, meaning you don't directly own a portion, interest in the common areas: the pool, tennis courts, grounds, hallways, laundry room, and so on. Although you and your tenants have full use and enjoyment of the common areas, remember that the homeowners association actually owns and maintains the common areas, as well as the building structures themselves, which typically include the foundation, exterior walls, roof, plumbing, electrical, and other major building systems. One advantage to a condo as an investment property is that of all the attached housing options, condos are generally the lowest maintenance properties from the perspective of unit owners, because most condominium or homeowners associations deal with issues such as roofing, landscaping, and so on for the entire building and receive the benefits of quantity purchasing. Note that you're still responsible for necessary maintenance inside your unit, such as servicing appliances, floor and window coverings, interior painting, and so on. Although condos may be somewhat easier to keep up, they tend to appreciate less than single-family homes or apartment buildings, unless the condo is located in a desirable urban area. Condominium buildings may start out in life as condos or as apartment complexes that are then converted into condominiums. Warning: be wary of apartments that have been converted to condominiums. Although they're often the most affordable housing options in many areas of the country, and may also be blessed with an excellent urban location that can't easily be recreated, you may be buying into some not-so-obvious problems. Our experience is that these converted apartments are typically older properties with cosmetic makeovers: new floors, new appliances, solid surface countertops, new landscaping, and a fresh coat of paint. However, be forewarned. The cosmetic makeover may look good at first glance, but the property probably still boasts 40-year-old plumbing, heating and cooling, and electrical systems, poor soundproofing, and a host of economic and functional obsolescence. Within a few years, most of the owner-occupants move on to the traditional single-family home and rent out their condos. You may then find the property is predominantly renter-occupied and has a volunteer board of directors unwilling to levy the monthly assessments necessary to properly maintain the aging structure. Within 10 to 15 years of the conversion, these properties may well be the worst in the neighborhood. Townhomes. Townhomes are essentially attached or row homes. a hybrid between a typical airspace-only condominium and a single-family house. Like condominiums, townhomes are generally attached, typically sharing walls and a continuous roof. But townhomes are often two-story buildings that come with a small yard and offer more privacy than a condominium, because you don't have someone living on top of your unit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.